All right, let's dive into eyelid anatomy. We've got some serious medical textbook excerpts here.
It's fascinating stuff, really. All the intricate detail in these tiny folds of skin that protect our vision.
It's amazing, right? We're going to break down all the terminology like meibomian glands, dyskeratosis. You'll be an eyelid expert by the end of this deep dive.
Absolutely. We'll cover the layers of the skin, the specialized glands, even touch on how doctors diagnose and treat eyelid problems.
Okay, so let's start with the eyelid itself. It's got three main components, right? The skin, the muscles, and the tarsus. But for this deep dive, we're focusing on the skin.
Right, because that's where you see a lot of the clinical signs. And it's actually the thinnest skin on your entire body.
Really? I never thought about that. So even though it's thin, it's still tough enough to do its job.
Exactly.
And like skin elsewhere, it's made up of the epidermis and the dermis.
Right. The epidermis is like the protective barrier.
Okay.
And the dermis is the support system underneath.
Okay, that makes sense. So let's break down the epidermis first. It's got four layers itself.
It does. And each one has its own job.
Wow.
Starting from the outside, you've got the stratum corneum, or the keratin layer.
Keratin, like what makes our hair and nail strong?
Exactly. It provides that waterproof barrier, protects against the elements, and prevents moisture loss.
Huh. So it's constantly being shed and replaced.
It is, constantly, by new cells migrating up from below.
That's wild. So what's happening beneath that keratin layer?
Well, just below, you've got the granular cell layer. It gets its name from these tiny granules that are actually precursors to keratin.
So like a keratin factory.
Exactly.
Cool. What's next?
Deeper still is the prickle cell layer, where the cells are connected by these junctions called desmosomes. They look kind of spiky under a microscope, hence the name.
Spiky cells? That sounds a little scary. But I get it. They need to hold on tight with all that blinking going on.
Right.
And then finally, the basal cell layer at the bottom.
That's right. The birthplace of new skin cells. They divide and push upward, becoming part of those outer layers we talked about.
So it's like a cellular conveyor belt. New cells are born, mature, fill up with keratin, and eventually become part of that tough outer shield. Incredible.
It is. And within this bustling epidermis, we also have melanocytes, which produce pigment.
Right. That's what gives our skin its color.
Exactly. We also have Langerhans cells, which are part of the immune system, and Merkel cells, thought to be involved in touch sensation.
Wow, a lot going on in that epidermis.
Okay.
So now let's get to the dermis, the layer beneath.
Yeah. The dermis is thicker, provides structural support. It's like the foundation. It's made up of connective tissue, has blood vessels, lymphatics, nerve fibers, all kinds of cells, fibroblasts, macrophages, mast cells.
Wow. So it's like the infrastructure of the eyelid keeping everything running.
Exactly. And the dermis and the epidermis are actually interlocked, like in a really interesting way.
Oh.
The dermis has these finger-like projections called papillae that extend upward. And the epidermis has downward extensions called rootlages.
Yeah.
They kind of interlock like a puzzle.
I'm picturing like two hands clasped together. But what's the purpose of all that?
It creates a larger surface area between the layers, which helps with nutrient exchange.
Oh, that makes sense. Like nature's Velcro, keeping it all together.
Exactly.
So I've got the skin, the epidermis, the dermis. Anything else we need to know before moving on?
We can't forget the annexa. The specialized structures within the eyelid skin, they're really important for the eyelid and the eye itself.
The annexa. Fill me in. What are those?
Think sebaceous glands, sweat glands, hair follicles. Each of these structures plays a unique role.
Okay, let's start with sebaceous glands. I know they produce sebum, that oily substance.
Right, and in the eyelids, there are a few different types. There's some in the caruncle, that little pink fleshy bit at the inner corner.
Oh yeah, I see it. Didn't know it had a name. What else?
Then there are tiny sebaceous glands associated with the vellus hairs, those fine hairs on the eyelid. But the real stars of the show are the meibomian glands.
Meibomian glands. Remind me what those are.
They're modified sebaceous glands located within the tarsal plates, those firm plates that give the eyelid its shape. Each eyelid has like 20 to 30 meibomian glands.
Wow.
Arranged in a row. Kind of like tiny toothpaste tubes.
Toothpaste tubes. That's a great analogy.
Right. And just like toothpaste, they're constantly releasing a substance called meibome. It forms the oily layer of the tear film.
The tear film, that thin layer of liquid on our eyes.
Exactly. And meibome is essential. It prevents the tears from evaporating too quickly, keeps the eyelids from sticking together, provides a smooth surface for the eyelids to glide over the eye.
So these tiny glands are responsible for comfortable vision. I never realized how important they are.
They're crucial.
So I bet if something goes wrong with those glands, you could have some serious dry eye problems.
Absolutely. Now, besides the meibomian glands, we also have the glands of Zeiss. Tiny sebaceous glands associated with the lash follicles. So each eyelash has its own little oil factory.
Wow, even our eyelashes have dedicated oil glands. Tell me about these glands of Mol. They sound mysterious.
They're modified sweat glands, more numerous in the lower lid. They open into the lash follicles or directly onto the lid margin.
Interesting. What about those eccrine sweat glands, the typical ones we have all over our bodies?
Right. They're distributed throughout the eyelid skin. They help regulate temperature and moisture.
Got it. So we've covered the skin, the dermis, and the adnexa. That's a lot packed into one tiny eyelid.
It is.
I'm starting to appreciate how complex these structures are.
And we've only just begun. To really understand eyelid conditions and how doctors diagnose them, we need to dive into their language.
Okay, bring on the vocabulary lesson. Hit me with it.
So you've got the anatomy down. Now let's talk about the language doctors use. Clinical terminology.
Okay, lay it on me. What kinds of terms are we talking about?
Well, let's say you've got a flat spot on your skin, different color, but not raised. That's called a macule. Think of a freckle.
Macule, flat discoloration.
Okay.
Got it. What if it is raised, though?
Then it's a papule, a solid elevation less than 1 centimeter, like a little bump, brown or flesh colored.
So like a mole.
Exactly. Now, if that raised area is filled with fluid, we call that a vesicle.
Oh, like a blister.
Exactly. And if that fluid-filled lesion is larger, like bigger than 0.5 centimeter, it's called a bulla, like a burn blister.
Ouch. Okay, so macules, papules, vesicles, bulla, what else?
Well, if it's a raised bump filled with pus, like a pimple, that's a pustule. And then dried exudate, like a scab, that's a crust.
Straightforward enough. What about those larger bumps you sometimes feel under the skin?
If you can feel a solid area larger than 1 centimeter, that's a nodule. And a cyst is a type of nodule that's fluid-filled. It has an epithelial lining, so like a little sac.
Okay, so nodules are solid, cysts are fluid-filled.
Got it.
What if the raised area is bigger than 1 centimeter, but flat on top?
That's a plaque. Psoriasis, for example, often presents with plaques. And speaking of skin conditions, we can't forget about scale. Flakes of shed keratin, like dandruff.
Ew. Dandruff of the eyelids. That's a thing.
It can happen. And finally, there's a papilloma, a benign, warty projection, like a skin tag.
Interesting. Are there any terms for, like, more serious skin problems?
Of course, an ulcer, for example, is a break in the skin, extends into the dermis, like a pressure sore. So those are some of the terms for describing, you know, the appearance of lesions, stuff you can see with your eyes.
That's a lot of new vocabulary. But it's definitely helpful. So we've got what we can see, but what about under a microscope?
That's where histological terminology comes in. Describes what's happening at the cellular level. Really important for understanding a lesion.
Okay, let's dive into the microscopic world then. What kinds of things are we looking for?
Well, one term you'll hear a lot is tumor. Now, in everyday talk, people think cancer, right? But in medical terms, tumor just means swelling. So any bump or lump could be called a tumor.
So not all tumors are cancerous.
Exactly. When we're talking about abnormal tissue growth, that's neoplasia, and that can be benign or malignant.
So benign is not spreading, malignant is.
Right. And to tell the difference under a microscope, doctors look for atypia, basically abnormal cell appearance. If the cells look weird, dividing strangely, that's a red flag.
So they're looking for cells that are misbehaving.
Basically. And if those atypical cells are disrupting the structure of the tissue, that's dysplasia. And our source material mentions carcinoma in situ, where the entire thickness of the epidermis is involved.
Carcinoma in situ. What is that exactly?
It's considered precancerous. The cells look like cancer cells, but they haven't spread beyond the top layer of skin.
Wow, so even subtle changes can be a big deal. Okay, what other histological terms should I know?
Well, there are a few that describe specific changes in the epidermis. Hyperkeratosis, that's one, just means a thickening of the keratin layer, that outer layer.
The one that provides protection. Makes sense that if that gets thicker, it would change how the eyelid looks and feels.
Right. Clinically, it often shows up as scaling. It can be caused by a bunch of different things, some benign, some not.
So not always a reason to panic, but good to get checked out. What about acanthesis? I remember seeing that earlier.
Acanthesis is thickening of the stratum spinosum, the prickle cell layer, the layer where cells are dividing, producing keratin.
So more cell division, is that always a bad thing?
Not necessarily. It can be a normal response to irritation, but it can also be associated with some skin conditions. So context is key.
Okay, so just because you see it doesn't mean it's a problem. What about discheratosis? That one sounds kind of scary.
Discheratosis is basically abnormal keratinization. Keratinization is normal. Cells mature and produce keratin, but it's supposed to happen in a specific way. In discheratosis, you see keratin being produced in cells that shouldn't be making it.
Like they're getting their signals crossed.
Exactly. And that can mess up the skin's structure and function.
Okay, last one, and then I think my brain is full. What was that one about cell nuclei? Perikeratosis.
You got it. Perikeratosis is when nuclei are retained in the stratum corneum, that outermost layer. Normally, those cells are dead, no nuclei. But in perikeratosis, those nuclei stick around, like they're refusing to die off.
That's a pretty vivid image. So these histological terms give doctors a lot of information about what's happening on a tiny scale.
They do, but it's important to remember they need to be interpreted in context. The patient's symptoms, medical history, the clinical appearance, it all matters.
Okay, so we've explored the microscopic world. Now let's zoom back out and talk about what happens when someone actually has an eyelid problem. How do doctors figure out what's going on and how to treat it? So we've covered so much, from those tiny layers of skin to all those microscopic terms, but what happens when things actually go wrong? How do doctors figure out what to do about eyelid lesions?
Well, first, they need to figure out where the lesion is coming from. Remember those three main categories: epidermal, adnexal, and dermal.
Yeah, epidermal for the top layer, adnexal for the glands and hair follicles, and dermal for the deeper layer.
Exactly. So knowing where it's coming from helps narrow down the possibilities.
Makes sense.
Let's start with epidermal lesions. Those often involve those keratinocytes and melanocytes we talked about.
Okay, so what are some common epidermal lesions?
Well, you might have heard of seborrheic keratosis. Those are those brown or black waxy-looking bumps that people get as they age.
Oh, yeah, I've seen those. My grandma has some on her face. They're harmless, right?
Usually, yes. But always good idea to get any new skin lesions checked out.
Right, of course.
Now, another common one is actinic keratosis. That's a precancerous condition from sun damage.
So too much sun without sunscreen.
Exactly. They often look like rough, scaly patches on sun-exposed areas, right? The face, hands, even the eyelids.
Really? I didn't realize you could get sun damage on your eyelids.
Oh, yeah.
Guess it makes sense to protect those, too.
Absolutely. Sunglasses and a wide-brimmed hat are your friends.
Good to know.
Then, of course, there's basal cell carcinoma, a type of skin cancer.
Skin cancer on the eyelid? That sounds serious.
It can be, but thankfully it's the most common type and it rarely spreads. But it can cause problems if it's not treated.
So early detection is key.
Absolutely. Regular skin checks are so important, especially if you see anything new or changing on your skin, including the eyelids.
Okay, that makes sense. Yeah. What about those adnexal lesions, the ones from the glands and hair follicles?
Right. One of the most common is a chalazion. It's a blocked meibomian gland, basically.
Oh, chalazion. I've had one of those. It wasn't painful, but it was this annoying little bump. Took forever to go away.
Yeah, they're common and usually harmless. Often go away on their own. Sometimes need a little help from a doctor.
Right. What about styes? Those are more painful, right?
Yeah, styes or hordeola are infections of a gland or hair follicle. They can be painful because, you know, inflammation, pus.
It felt like a little volcano erupting on my eyelid.
They often clear up with warm compresses, though. Sometimes an antibiotic ointment.
Okay, so those are a couple of common adnexal lesions. What about dermal lesions?
Dermal lesions, those involve the dermis, the deeper layer. So things like cysts, those fluid-filled sacs, lipomas, benign fatty tumors, and dermatofibromas, firm bumps that often happen after an injury, like a bug bite.
Wow, so many different things can happen in such a small area.
It is remarkable, and that's why a careful exam and sometimes a biopsy is important.
Okay, so we've got those three main categories. Before we wrap up, I wanted to ask about blepharitis. I've heard of that.
Blepharitis, yeah, it's super common. It's inflammation of the eyelid margins, you know, where the eyelashes grow.
I've heard it can be itchy, crusty, make your eyelids red.
Yeah, it can be pretty annoying. There are two main types, anterior and posterior.
Okay.
Anterior blepharitis affects the outer part where the eyelashes are, often caused by bacteria or dandruff.
And posterior involves the inner part where the meibomian glands are.
Exactly. If the meibomian glands aren't working right, not enough oil, that can lead to inflammation, problems with the tear film.
So it's a chronic thing, can be caused by all sorts of things.
Pretty much. And it can be a recurring problem, but there are ways to manage it. eyelid hygiene, warm compresses, sometimes medications.
Well, this has been quite a journey. I feel like I've learned so much.
It's amazing, right? All that complexity packed into such a small area, and we've only just scratched the surface.
I'm definitely looking at my eyelids with new appreciation now. And if I see anything weird, I'll know to get it checked out.
That's the key. Early detection is so important.
Absolutely. Well, thanks for joining us on the Deep Dive. We'll see you next time.